Hello guys, good morning. Nice to meet you all. I'm Ivan from SME's Technologies, and today I will try to give you an overview, general overview about the in-system programming. And the content of this presentation will be how to put the ISP in practice, like in your production line, in your industrial environment. We will have some talk about the on-socket programming, a programming method that is that was used in the past. And after that, I will also try to introduce about something about the advantages and disadvantages that the ISP programming can bring to your production line, and also the criticalities that you have to face in order to program microcontrollers through programmers, of course. At the end of the presentation, I will try to give you an overview about the future innovation, and I will try to give you knowledge about the new challenges that we are trying to face in this field. And of course, I will try to give some guidelines about the countermeasure that could be taken in order to face these new challenges of the ISP program. So the on-socket programming was the only programming method used until the 90s. It was a programming method that was based on putting the microcontroller inside the socket and programming through the communication protocol lines. As you can imagine, this kind of programming method is free from disturbances and interferences that could come out from other components on the board, because actually you just put the microcontroller on the socket and then you program it. Maybe you can just do some external circuitry around the microcontroller to make it work fine for the flashing, but there are no other components that could interfere with the programming. At that time, there were just technologies that were one-time programmable, like OTP memories or EEPROM memories that could not be erased or just erased through an ultraviolet light. So this system was actually a good method to program the microcontrollers. But with the innovation and so on, with the new technologies like EEPROM and flash memories and microcontrollers, for example, it was kind of an outdated method, because then you could not actually update a firmware already running inside the microcontroller and already mounted on the board. Because if you imagine, like, once you mount the microcontroller on the board, you have to unmount it from the board and then place it inside the socket again, and it could be really hard to have some update on the firmware. So the in-system programming board from early 90s, and in this way you could actually program the devices already mounted on the board. And in this way, of course, updating and other stuff like on-air updating firmware could be take place in this way. And this new method also free the production from the rigidity that the on-socket programming was actually giving. On the on-socket programming, you also had to actually collect microcontrollers before the programming, and it had a lot of warehouse cost, for example, and in this way you just can modelize your production line and perform your in-system programming. And this is a slide where the advantages and disadvantages of both methods are summed up. As I said before, for the on-socket programming, the device was placed on a socket and there were no interferences from other components. It was, of course, easier to integrate the microcontroller or the memories or the OTP memory inside the socket and perform the programming phase. But as I said, it had a lot of production rigidity, and the warehouse costs were excessive. Also, there was a problem about versioning. Like, you cannot really know or certificate a non-socket programming, because it was not all together. The programmer was separated from the actually programming phase, and there was no a complete system that was programming the memories. With the in-system programming, instead, you have more flexibility, more versatility in programming the devices already mounted on the board. And of course, you can merge the flashing phase together with the test phase once the firmware is placed inside the memory of the microcontroller. And as well, you can develop the hardware and the software in parallel, all together. You don't have to first program the microcontroller or the memory and then place it in the board. And as a, and the main advantage is that once the microcontroller is programmed, you don't have to unmount it from the PCB and program it again on the socket. You can just program it already during the production. You can just update the firmware already during the production phase. Of course, the disadvantages of this in-system programming is that higher attention should be given to the integration of the programmer inside the programming system, and also you have to take care of the interferences, the reset lines, some watchdogs that you could put inside the board that could interrupt the flashing phase. So yes, more attention to the PCB, to the design of the PCB, to not, of course, interrupt the flashing phase or interfere with the flashing phase. For low production volume, usually there is the human participation, and there are dedicated connectors that are placed on the board, and where you can connect the programmer and program the microcontroller. For high production volumes, you have industrial production lines that are automated, usually, and that that use fixtures or ATE, fixtures integrated in ATE, to program your microcontrollers, your devices already mounted on board, or the whole panel of boards. In this way, you have some test points, you have the programming test points that are some dots on the board, basically, where you can connect with the needle of the fixture, and you can perform the programming of the microcontroller of the devices. This is an image of a directly to the needles, and it's performing the programming of the PCB, of the panel, of the microcontroller mounted on the board. The high-speed programmer can be different, of course. You can choose to apply a manufacturer programmer or a universal programmer. So the manufacturer programmer is usually developed by the silicon producer that is producing the microcontroller mounted on the board. It can program, of course, microcontroller coming out from that silicon producer specifically, and typically it has lower performances compared to the universal programmer. Of course, the number of communication protocols supported by these programmers are based on the communication protocol with the microcontroller which the microcontrollers are communicating with. So usually they develop only the protocols that are needed to program the microcontroller. And also it has less flexibility than a universal programmer, because it is harder to develop custom solution for project needs or customer needs. It is typically single channel, and as an advantage it has a lower cost, but it's a compromise of all the other disadvantages. For the universal programmer, we have the universal programmer is a programmer developed by a third party company. It is a universal, so it can program every kind of microcontrollers which has a memory inside, a neuron inside, or whatever. And everything that is programmable inside of the microcontroller. And it is not silicon specific. It is done to optimize flashing routines and to optimize the programming cycle to lower down the production cost. Because time in production line is money, so flashing routine should be fast and should be performant. And of course, the universal programmers are supporting every kind of communication protocol, the tag in the world, SWD, I2C, and so on. So, because of course, it should program every kind of microcontrollers, and every microcontroller has its own communication protocol. I listed the most famous one, but we have a lot of minor protocol, own proprietary protocol coming from silicon producers. And of course, with these universal programmers, you can also require to develop some customized features that can allow the programmer to have custom designs to program custom projects. And for example, here we have the flash runner, which reaches up to 16 channels and multi-channel available. So you can program 16 targets in parallel. Now we have the criticalities of the ISP programming method. Of course, as you can imagine, the wires quality and length could influence the protocol frequencies and also the stability of the programming process. The programmer's integration inside the AT or the fixtures, this is also could be a criticality if not done correctly, because it could limit the potential of the programmer, limit its performances. So maybe you are using it in at a lower frequency, at a lower frequency. It's less performant, and the time is increasing, the production time and also the cost. And there are also the criticalities of the external components that are interfering with the flashing process. And as well, there are some sensitive protocols that are used, for example, to program huge sized memories like eMMCs or NAND memories, OptoSPI serial memories. These kind of architectures have a sensitive protocol to communicate with, and it could be very critical to program these kind of memories with the ISP method, because of course of the quality of the whole system that could decrease the stability and could interfere with the programming process of the memories. Some common standards, some good practices that should be followed in order to have a good environment for the flashing phase are listed here. The connection between the programmer and the target should be as short as possible, as short as the fixture or the AT allows, of course. We have different communication protocols, some are more robust, some are more are not robust. So, of course, this connection really depends on the communication protocol that is used to program the microcontrollers. All the signals should have the same distance from the programmer to the target, used to allow stability in the propagation of the signal. And, of course, if you have discontinuities
and so on, you should take care in your production line that everything is correctly matched. The impedance between the discontinuities is correctly matching in order to have a stable programming phase. Also, as a good practice, it is suggested to use twisted line with a ground line twisted on it, and also shielded cables to protect from interferences and so on. As I was saying before, once the microcontroller is rooted inside the board, you have all the external circuitry that could interfere with the programming of this microcontroller. So it is a good practice to protect the flashing phase of the microcontroller from these interferences that comes from the outer components inside the board. And of course, if you have some hardware that is placed in the middle of the connection between the programmer and the target, also it should be considered that this kind of hardware could create some disturbances, noise, for example, relay cabling, detector, because it should be kept in mind that during the ISP programming phase, there should be also some testing phase in the middle. So there could be some hardware that is detaching the ISP lines from the testing phase, and this hardware should be considered while during the flashing process. About the future, there are, from our experience, many complexes boards are coming and with multiple devices mounted on the boards. For example, different technologies like microcontrollers or serial memories and EMC and so on. And also, a huge amount of data should be transferred between the during the programming phase to program these huge size memories, for example, EMCs or NAND. So the solution should be to have a programmer that is able to manage different technologies, which means different communication protocol, and also to program them in parallel in order to increase the production efficiency and to lower down the cost and the programming cycle, programming time. This is an example of FlashNumber HS, which is able to program multiple technologies through these different active modules. And on this universal programmer, there could be also applied some customized routines that could satisfy the customer needs in order to program their panel, their boards, their microcontrollers, their architectures. This is an example on how to place the target as close as possible to the devices in order to program them efficiently with an accurate protocol frequency and stabilizing the whole process. That's only a control unit that is managing the active modules. The programming phase is actually happening on these active modules. And they are really small, so they could be placed inside the ATE or the fixtures. And in this way, you can shorten the cable wiring and use higher protocol frequencies. And in this way, you can transfer huge amount of data in a very short time. Above all, when the communication protocol is strictly dependent on the frequency, communication frequency used. For example, EMCs, NAND memories, OptoSPI serial memories are using protocols that are strictly dependent on the frequency. So the higher you go on the frequency, the faster will be the programming phase. So having the target really close to the programmer is a good way to increase the frequency and lower down the programming time. How to reduce the programming time? Of course, there's the solution to optimize the programming routines of the programmer, of the software that is running inside the programmer. That is actually what I do. And of course, increase the communication protocol frequency between the programmer and the target. There is a solution that we are actually applying in some custom projects, which is to program these bit size memory through the microcontroller SPI interface, called SPI interfaces. To program the microcontroller, there's a communication protocol that is more robust than the communication protocol that is used for serial memories, NAND of the SPI serial memories and MCs. So if a programming routine is placed inside the microcontroller through the, for example, SWD protocol, then you can program the memory from inside the microcontroller. And you have, of course, less noise, less disturbances, less, let's say, interferences that could come out from the lines. And it is a solution that we consider in the case that the industrial environment is really noisy and the lines are not of good quality, the cable is not good quality cable, the length are really long, the length of the cable is high, so you cannot go up in the frequency, and you could have better performances by applying this programming method. In the future, there could be PCB or wireless fixture, for example. So you have actually a PCB that is performing the programming, connecting the programmer to the target. In this PCB, you can place, for example, the connectors, the whole ISP programmer, and in this way, you have a complete system that is a full block, and in this way, you could increase the performances of the programming phase. Of course, it should be paid a lot of attention during the design phase of the PCB, because it is hard to actually remodel it once it has been created. For example, here you can see that some cables have been wired up because of the design was actually failing at the beginning. I don't know if it's a mistake on the net. But having a full block could allow you to certificate the whole production line in a one shot. For example, you have the PCB fixture that is programming the microcontrollers, you have the ISP programmer on it. And since the certification is becoming more and more a must, for example, in the automotive and aerospace field, this is a method that allows you to certificate the whole production line in one shot. And of course, there should be also a software, a graphical user interface that could allow our customer to manage and to handle the various platforms that will perform the ISP programming. The idea of the graphical user interface is that it needs to be intuitive and simple, because every customer is using it. It's not an engineer, it's not a technician. Everyone should use it in order to perform the programming process. But of course, it should have also some advanced features, and it should take some sophisticated action on the ISP programmer. So we developed actually a professional graphical user interface that is very user-friendly and intuitive, but that has a lot of security features inside and sophisticated action that could be